in this all-out quest for a breakthrough, something has come to my mind. Ask the Holy Spirit, you know, what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? Here's the idea. Is there, can we have such a situation as part-time enlightenment? Well, why not? Vision of oneness has come to me several times. It faded. That was part-time, right? It didn't harm me in any way. So why can't the vision of oneness come for a while and then fade away for a while? And I say this because it seems to me that because of our continuity problem, it's so severe, not only ours, but everyone in the world is so severe, there's enormous resistance to abiding in the vision of oneness continuously. People simply freak out. They will not be able to understand it, really. I've said that we need to be very diplomatic, and that is, say, well, I'm going to just test drive this for a couple of years and see how it goes. Well, let's take it one step further. How about if we test drive it on a part-time basis for a couple of years? Okay, let's give ourselves a little bit of, you know, ease the continuity for a little bit. Let's say, instead of, you know, the idea of, like, we got to make this breakthrough into enlightenment, and then we're enlightened forever, and that's it. How about, that seems to cause too much of pressure. How about, say, you know, vision of oneness, when I ask for it, let it come. And then when circumstances, perhaps it's not the best idea, okay, let it go. And then call it back, let it come again. Part-time enlightenment. It's a new concept, actually, a new way of looking at it, but it makes sense to me. Because I can say for sure, when I saw the vision of oneness, it was so wonderful that you cannot explain it, really. And if you were to abide in this vision of oneness, you would be absolutely ecstatic. Ecstatic. And just can't even describe it. It is so awesome. It is so awesome. So obviously the issue of functionality has to come up. It has to come up. Now, what if you looked at this vision one and says, well, I'm going to feel this way for several hours. I'm going to look at this for several hours, and then I'm going to stop. Now, we might think, horrors, you know, we spent our whole life trying to get this. We're not going to stop. But what if we could start again? What if we could start again? Then would it be so bad to stop? So I'm looking at this in different lights, and hey, wait a minute, let's take control of the situation and say, okay, let's have the vision of oneness for a while, and then say, okay, let's stop for now. Come out of it. And then later, go into it and then come out of it. And the going into it is so completely smooth and gentle, just this small little shift, actually. Hardly perceptible, just a shift in emphasis and attention, just a slight shift in attention. Whew, there it is. So easy to go into it and then maybe out of it. Easy to go into and out of it, or less sort of back off a little bit from it. It's not mind-blowing like enlightenment where suddenly you see the world new and that's it, you never go back. No, it's not like that. So you can't, it's just a shift of attention. It's there all the time. All you have to do is shift your attention to it. So you can shift it on and then you can shift it off if you want to. You don't have to keep it on all there. It's not going to go away. If you shift off of it, it's not going to get upset and feel humiliated and say, oh, you don't like this, huh? Well, okay, I'm going to block you. There's no blockage there. It's there all the time for us. So, oh, yeah, we can shift there whenever we want to. Now, this brings us to the area of spiritual ambition, which we've been focusing on. And I find that, you know, the ambition says, hey, you can't do that. You got to be enlightened. You got to say, I'm an enlightened guru, master. I've seen the vision of oneness. I'm abiding in it. And here I am. Whereas if you go into it and then back off of it, you know, there'll be times when you seem inspired, and other times you know, no. And people will say, well, you know, maybe he's, you know, he's got some sort of some mystical visions occasionally and stuff like that, but they're not enlightened. That's not enlightenment. And so you sort of seem to have a lower profile in the world. So, if it works, it works. Who cares about the profile, right? That's spiritual ambition to a certain extent. So this is a, at least it's a hopeful way, because I don't have any other answers at this moment, because I know the vision of oneness is there, but for some reason I don't shift onto it. My attention is not, I'm not able to get my attention there. I know it's very simple, but the simplicity is eluding me at this point. And I need to do something shifted. That's all I got going for me in my life right now. So I need to be able to shift to the vision of oneness. But I don't feel it's practical to be able to just shift, make a shift, and then just stay there forevermore. That's very idealistic, isn't it? Spiritually romantic. But I don't think it's practical. So I have to float this idea. Holy Spirit floated this idea to me. How about this? And I said, sure, why not? Whatever works. Whatever works. Now that means that, for instance, if you were going to be sitting with some people or a situation or somewhere where you really needed to be reassuring that the vision of oneness is really there, you could shift into it. Okay, and then when you needed to maybe go to work and deal with all this, you know, people and stuff in work, you can, you know, just shift out of it, back away from it a little bit. We need to interact with family, with friends, and all stuff. Back off of it. And try that for a while. Try that for a while. But the whole paradigm of enlightenment, where, you know, all we get is this, you work and work, and you finally have Satori, you have the breakthrough, and poof, you know, you're there, and that's it. Well, that hasn't seemed to have worked, and so this new paradigm of part-time enlightenment, and maybe, I don't know, it's it I don't have any objection to it at this point. I used to have a lot of objection to this. I never would have thought of this, but now I'm saying sure, from what I've experienced, vision of oneness is a piece of cake. And actually, if you feel that you could back off of it, then I think you'd be more likely to go into it. Absolutely. If you say, well, it's just a 2-hour thing, then I think you could really feel comfortable with it. If you felt after 2 hours you could say, okay, that's enough, and then back off of it, then you could really immerse yourself in it. But if you felt that you needed to immerse yourself in this forevermore, you're not going to do it. The continuity fear is going to bite you. And so then you get frantic, like, I need to grab a hold of this, I need to make it more intense, because it seems to be, I don't want it to slip away. If you say, no, I'm going to intentionally have it let it slip away in a couple hours, so I don't need to make it too intense, all right? I don't need to get the whole feeling right now, just let it sit there. Let's just sit there quietly and just let it be there, and don't try to push the whole situation somehow. Let the light come, and just sit there, and you say, okay, light, thank you for coming, and now, could you just sort of go to the back of the room there for a while, because I'm dealing with some other stuff, and then come on to the front, you know, like that. This is it's something I never really thought about, actually, but is worth considering. But we feel so unworthy of the light. We think if we get a little bit of light, somehow the light is gracing us. We have to bow down and word, oh, thank you for gracing me, light. I'm so blessed. This is amazing. The idea of saying, hey, light, you know, this is great, but can you leave me? I need you to leave me for a little while. That doesn't enter our mind, does it? Because we feel like so unworthy, and you think something like this is so rare and incredible. To say, hey, light, this is, thank you very much, but I need you to back off a little bit right now. Come on back a little later. This just, you know, just doesn't enter our mind. Like, who could say that? Why are we? That's. But remember, light is answering our request. We're the ones who ask light to, our desires are what light responds to. So we're in charge of the light. Light's not in charge of us. So why shouldn't we be able to say, oh, thank you, light. Okay, light, need to back off a little bit right now. Take charge of our spiritual functioning that way. But we don't see it that way, do we? We see, oh my God, somehow God has blessed me something like this, and you know, I'm so completely grateful. This is absolutely amazing, and I hope it stays. I don't know what's gonna happen. That hasn't seemed to work. And we shouldn't be craving that way. We shouldn't be craving. We should be able to say, hey, I can shift into the vision oneness anytime I want to. I just request the light. Light, turn the attention of this actual false witness in this paradigm of light, this scheme of light that is, we ask to deceive us. False witness, turn your attention to the vision of oneness. And just tell light what you want. Tell light what you want. Because when we tell light, hey, well, light, what I want is this to... this sudden enlightenment that is just unbelievably intense, beyond anything I could possibly imagine. I want that to remain forever, like that. Do we really want that, or do we vacillate and say, whoa, wait a minute, light, not yet. Don't we always end up saying, not yet, not yet, not yet, wait, not yet. But if we said, hey, light, give, I'd like to have this experience for, an hour, two hours, and then I want you to back off. That's your orders. That's my desire. I'm talking about forever here. Just talking about 2 hours. Take it 2 hours at a time. Maybe we wouldn't say, well, wait a minute, not ready. No, wait a minute. Maybe we just say, yeah, right now, let's do it for 2 hours at a time. I think that's why people use drugs, actually. It is, they're trying to do this. Their idea is, hey, I'll take this drug, I'll feel a certain way for a couple hours, and then it'll wear off. And it's sort of like unconsciously trying to deal with their continuity fears, right? But what if we could actually consciously say, hey, light, please come, envision of oneness, equal presence of light, please come for a little while, and then, okay, back off for a little while. Now we understand, it's only a matter of our attention, you see. The equal presence of the light is always equally present, but our attention can either be on that or turned away from it. So it doesn't cause any problems to turn your attention away from it. It doesn't mean you don't believe it. It doesn't mean it wasn't true. The idea, see, this belief system that light is presenting to us says, hey, you must not like it, because if you liked it, you would have stayed with it. Right, so maybe you must not, or if it was real, genuine, you would have stayed with it, and you wouldn't have said go away or withdrawn from it. So there must be something wrong with it. Not true. See, that's the continuity fear. Again, when we own the continuity fear, we get real smart, and we can say to that light, the fences we call the ego, that's not true. I told it to go. I told my attention to shift off, but because of the continuity issue. I want to get used to it gradually. That's fine. It has nothing to do with it not being appropriate or anything like that. So we can turn the light like that. We can turn the light toward us, you know. Then we can, after a while, we can turn it away from us. Like our attention, the light's always there. So it doesn't mean the light's disappearing from us. It means our attention is turning off of it. And people might say, oh, that's not enlightenment. Well, if you can shift your attention to vision to oneness, I guarantee you, that's what you really want. Forget about people's definitions of enlightenment. Vision to oneness is so absolutely incredible. You just will be astonished at what you see. Perfection. Eternal life. Perfection. omnipresence. Nothing wrong with anyone. Nobody's suffering at all. Total support, equal support for everyone. And you're not thinking, gee, is this enlightenment or not? No, you're saying this is exactly what I really want to see. This is exactly it. Not saying, am I enlightened? Is this enlightenment? There's no thoughts like that. You're just like, wow, this is what I really want to see. Like that. But the thought of being in this new, seeing this continuously as you're dealing with friends and family and with work and everything else, you might say, whoa, wait a minute, people might think I'm crazy or something. Right? So give them a chance to kind of gradually get used to the fact that you can shift and see this vision of oneness. And they get used to it, and then maybe you can shift into it more and more. Maybe you may stay in it more and more over the years. And eventually maybe stay in it full time. What's wrong with that? Why not a little bit of gradualism here? Understanding our continuity fear is preventing us from even doing it at all. So I'd say it's better to have some gradualism than not doing it at all. I seem to recall when I was really young, I was able to shift in and out of states. And then I lost the ability to do that. It must be the world scoffing at that and saying, who do you think you are? The great masters, they would all perpetually enlighten. You know, that's the only, good for the great masters, you know. That's great for them, happy for them. But we have a severe continuity fear. The worst world has a gigantic continuity fear. We're not living in a Himalayan cave like Longchenpa did. We're functioning in a super sophisticated, cooperative culture where everybody expects everybody else to be on the ball and get their job done, and people are driving like maniacs, and pressure, and all this stuff. You know? So, you know, be pragmatic. The Holy Spirit's pragmatic. Yeah. If we're sitting in the cave, we can sit in the cave for the next 20 years. Maybe we would simply abide in the vision of oneness continuously. And everybody we met in that culture knew what we were doing and approved of it. And, you know, there's no pressure to do anything. You just, cycles of nature just happen, grow a little rice and have a yak or something and pick some berries and that's it. And it's a completely different situation now. We just, so why not adapt to the situation? What's wrong with that? Maybe this is just the new style of enlightenment here, is to be so in control of the situation, know it so well and understand the whole picture, just shift into it when you need to and shift out of it when it's appropriate to. I don't see why that is anything lesser necessarily. Now they say that this, the enlightenment just destroys, completely shatters and destroys illusion that's gone forever and stuff like that. I didn't experience that in the vision of oneness at all. I was actually driving my truck on a tense freeway, actually. That was one time, the other on a road, driving with lots of traffic. And so I was in this, seeing the vision of oneness. I was driving, and I just said, holy cow. I was just aware of these facts of perfection. And I said, I got to keep driving here, and I couldn't get into it too much. But it was that simple. It was that simple. It wasn't anything complex where you sit down and you're doing all these breathing exercises and you're trying to raise the kundalini and you're, you know, fasting and everything. No, I was just normal day, just driving my truck at work. just insisting I don't have space is primary, spaciousness is primary, rather than the form, and emphasizing formlessness over form in my mind, emphasizing formlessness over form. And then I just was aware then, like, different perspective, just imperceptible. I didn't notice any click, any physiological changes or anything. It's just somehow my attention just subtly shifted. And it was fantastic. So let's give this a try. I'm going to try this as a last ditch effort. Why not? I'll accept that. And people can say whatever they want to. Say, well, he's not enlightened. Fine. I think I'm beyond worrying about stuff like that. And we can do the same thing like with prosperity. We don't need to have millions of dollars pouring and everything. Maybe just enough to pay your bills, and that's fine. Really. So, let's see what happens with this. This is a new paradigm, a new way of looking at the situation, and I'll see what it leads to. All right, very great. That's it.